Good afternoon. Together with our pastor, Father David Bonner, it is my great pleasure to welcome you to this afternoon's concert. We're delighted to co-sponsor this evening's program in conjunction with Duquesne University, the Duquesne University chapter of the American Guild of Organists, and the Pittsburgh chapter of the American Guild of Organists. In a special way, we welcome Dr. Anne Lewinsky and Rebecca Wife, who together have put so much hard work into the effort of planning this 10-day marathon. This afternoon culminates this full performance of Charles Tournemire's The Word Mystique in the last of 10 concerts. So to both of you, welcome. At this time, I ask you to silence all electronic devices. Restrooms can be found in the back of the church via the two stairwells, men and women's. And also, there's a handicapped unisex restroom in the back right-hand corner of the church on this level. Following this evening's concert, a reception will be held in Clairville Hall. We'd ask that you use these two doors at the front transept here to access the hall. It's just one floor down. And the concert reception will be held in the front transept of Clairville Hall. The next concert on our youth series here at St. Bernard and Our Lady of Grace is a continuation of our annual tradition of the Festival of Nine Lessons and Prayers. It's jointly sponsored with our parish and the Mount Lebanon Methodist Church Chancel Choir. That'll be held on Sunday, December 8th at 4 o'clock here at St. Bernard. Richard Spotts is no stranger to be working here at St. Bernard's. In addition to being a world-class organist, he also works for the Emery Brothers. And it was the Emery Brothers who were responsible for the restoration of this organ over 10 years ago. We're delighted to welcome Rich back to the organ this afternoon, and even more so later to be the 10th and final concert of this series. Therefore, it's both a privilege to and an honor at this time, and without further delay, to welcome Mr. Richard Spotts.
Thank you all for coming and to this the final installment of Lord of the Sea. I'll repeat some of the information because we have some new people here this evening. But for every one of these recitals, we've done a little bit of an introduction describing the pieces there for each act. We're going to take a brief interview in between the two parts, just a couple minutes just to rest our ears for a moment. And then we'll continue with the second. So, we are continuing with the chorale Hallelujah to the Sweet. For those of you who are just joining us, the large packet that you are reading at the door is a biography of Tournemire and a little history of the Lord of the Sweet. And you'll see all the movements and all the names and movements and different information like that. And as part of that packet, you'll see that Tournemire divided the season of Pentecost into three suites, and then with an opening and concluding section. And so tonight we are concluding the third suite, which is the chorale Hallelujah to the Sweet. And the chants, well, by and large, were the first office for tonight. Basically, speaks for themselves. All the chants speak for themselves. The chorale Hallelujah to the Sweet, number 4, let my prayers be set forth in my sight as incense. It's a very evocative piece of music, creating the imagery of smoke from the thoroughbung of the church. I think it's notable because it will sound very reminiscent to the introit from Durafle's Requiem. It has a lot of the same characteristics. It's not a direct quotation, but it has a lot of the same characteristics. Chant flowing over a 16th note pattern, a brief middle interlude, and then the chant coming back in duet form over a triplet pattern, just like the Requiem introit from the Durafle's Requiem. Durafle can attribute a lot to his musical taste and ideas to Tournemire, and this is one of the places where he got his ideas from. The next, the 20th Sunday after Pentecost, the next office, again, I think the chance speak for themselves. I have always been drawn to by the waters of Babylon. It's very, it's a powerful woman. It's a very intimate rendition of that psalm text, and it's incredibly powerful. Then we come to the Feast of All Saints. The Feast of All Saints marks the first office, beginning the conclusion of Lord's Feast. And actually, not only does it structurally mark the conclusion, it also, in a way, marks the beginning of Lord's Feast. When Tournemire wrote Lord's Feast, he began with five festivals. And my brain is going blank on Easter, Christmas, Pentecost, Assumption, and All Saints. So, and All Saints was the last one that he wrote in that opening set. And at first he was going to call Lord's Feast Lord Wyatt. And when he finished the Feast of All Saints, he scratched it out and wrote this is now going to be written, called Lord's Feast. And then he started from the beginning of the liturgical year and wrote it straight through. So in a way, even though we're reaching the conclusion of Lord's Feast, in a way, this is also its beginning. And again, I think the chants speak for themselves. I think I've always been drawn to the growl of All Saints, and it really represents theodicy of sainthood, the struggle of the saint, and the final apotheosis that a saint has with God through all their struggles and ultimately in death, coming to a new union with God. And the final words of that union speak for themselves. It's it is one more powerful, most powerful. Moments in Lord's Feast. After that, we'll take a break. That said, thank you so much for coming today, and be sure to introduce yourselves to me afterwards at the reception following downstairs. So thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, we might as well get started with the second act, because we have a reception within. Don't put the cold lights get colder. So we are now right in the middle of the concluding part of Word Mystique. And these last pieces are the last Sundays after Pentecost. I think that, again, a lot of these chants very much speak for themselves. I think we have to remember, as we get further and further through Lord Mystique, we are getting deeper and deeper into the Great Depression, and we're getting on the heels of the rising Hitler. And Lord Mystique was begun in 1927. Before the crisis really started to hit. It was by 1931 that the Depression really had sunk in, and both in America and in Europe. And financial turmoil was under a great amount of stress. And I think in a lot of the later movements of Lord Mystique, you get a sense that things are getting more troubling, and music is starting to react to that. I personally find it beginning with the chorales, which are a much more stoic form, and rather than the hallelujahs, which are a little more flamboyant and joyous. The offertory to this, the first office that we're doing for the second half, is a passage from Job. Tournemire saw a lot of the suffering that he was starting to go through, some of the issues that he went through as far as losing his wife and then not getting the conservatoire position, which was his teacher's former post. And in a way, Lord Mystique was meant as a rejuvenation of life after depression that lasted pretty much most of the 1920s and lingered on in the 1930s. And Job, to him, represented a suffering servant in trying to maintain fortitude in suffering. And so this offertory is unusual in its power. It's normally the offertory is in the liturgical, integrated liturgical movements are much more meditative. This is not. The next, in the next office, the penultimate office of Lord Mystique, I think that, again, the chants speak for themselves, but I have always been drawn to postlude hallelujah team. the whole heart really and joyfully it is for brotherness and God together in unity. And I love this intention. It is like a precious ointment upon you, the head that ran down unto the beard, even unto Aaron's beard. And so you'll hear the anointing of oil, the droplets falling, and then it falling down to the face, the falling down the beard. And it's just a beautiful image. I actually tend to use this in postlude as part of ecumenical services, say like Thanksgiving and things like that. So it's a wonderful piece. And then we get to the final office of Lord and Stephen. Stephen Schlosser, who wrote a very excellent book on, it's called Jazz Age Catholicism, but it's less to do about jazz, it's more a time period. It deals with the church in France, in particular, in the first part of the 20th century. The church had undergone the Dreyfus Affair, Church of France undergone the Dreyfus Affair, which was a hugely controversial episode in French history. And arguably, this was something incurred by the French military. In times of stress, people tend to take sides, and in times of anger, their issues become parodies of in and of themselves. They become parodies of what they believe. And in that crisis, as a result, we saw the French church, which had been usurped by the government during the French Revolution and later during Napoleon. As a result of the Dreyfus Affair, it severed ties from the government, but that meant that the church lost a lot of its holdings. It confiscated, and monasteries and convents were banished. And it was a time of great suffering for the church. And as a result of World War I, the church, France found a new unity, and the church monasteries were welcomed back on places like Salem. And as a result, Lord and Steve happened because he got Tournemire, got introduced to Salem and their chant studies, and there was a rebirth of liturgical music in France. That said, Tournemire wrote this after this period of depression that happened, and he was hoping that this liturgical tradition and the Franc tradition would be vindicated through Lord Stephen. And Stephen Schlosser saw the communion as of this movement before this office as the meaning of Lord with Steve, or the prayer of Lord with Steve. Amen. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them. And I would have to agree with Stephen Schlosser, but I think this was his ultimate prayer of vindication for the Franklin tradition, for the vocation of the organist as an artist philosopher, and not just as an entertainer, because this is, you don't build church organs. Well, churches don't take building organs lightly. Institutions that yell at you for not turning out the lights because they're afraid of paying, they can't pay the electric bill, will build an instrument that costs more than the house. And they are doing that because they believe in the power of the instrument and the message that it has to convey. Ultimately, it's the message that's important. and it needs to be, it can only be translated through this instrument, or at least this instrument effectively, and not instruments that appeal to pop culture and so forth. So Amen Dikobobis, I think, is his ultimate prayer. It didn't work out. He would die a couple years later, very mysteriously, and he would die forgotten. And I think that it is time to revisit this and revisit this message, especially in the times that we are facing right now. So I will reaffirm that the prayer opens the prayer of everyone else. And then we end with the fantasy on the today. And you'll see it juxtapose this church, this song of thanksgiving is the final amen to this whole piece. And you'll see it juxtapose to texts like Out of the Deep, Have I Called Unto Thee, and O Lord, that saves us from our enemies. This is exclamation point to that prayer, and actually also it is also a reminder of the ominous things that were on the doorstep happening just a few years later after the composition of Lord Speak. That said, I think it's time to do the inclusion of Lord Speak. Thank you very much, and I'm sure you introduce yourselves to me after the service or after the program. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.